Welcome to Sady Says. I am Natalie Sady, and joining me today is Graham Wetzbarger, expert luxury authenticator. Welcome.
Thanks for having me.
Well, thank you for being here. I mean, what woman doesn't love luxury goods? And so I get to talk to you all day about all the things.
All the things.
All the things. So, first of all, I want to know, at what point did you develop a passion for luxury goods?
Very early on. One of my like earliest like cognitive memories is like touch and feel of like this velvet jacket that my grandmother had. And to me, like velvet was like just the feel of luxury. And I remember like when she was done wearing it, she cut a swatch out of it and sent it to me so I could like have it. And like ever since then, I've been like swatching, whether it's like tearing sheets out of magazines of luxurious things or getting like, you know, paint samples at the Home Depot for my dream house someday. Or, you know, it's just about collecting and aggregating luxury.
So Graham, why are consumers loving luxury resale?
Well, I think there's a few reasons. First, there's the fashion obsessed. And these are people who read every issue of every magazine, who follow all the runway shows. And I always say, like, regardless of the size of your wallet, there's always more fashion than there is money. So we make choices every season or as we need to acquire different garments. Maybe it's like, oh, I have to have the oversized white chunky knit cable knits, but whatever. But you're not going to do this item. And then in retrospect, we're like, dang, I wish I had really got the oatmeal one or whatever it is. So in resale, those items become available again. Because at you know, in a traditional department store or boutique, you're only seeing that season. And normally it's a few months out anyways, especially the more high up in luxury you go, the farther out people are shopping. So by the time it might actually be weather appropriate to wear that Louis Vuitton puffer coat, it's been sold out for months. So then you turn to the secondary market. Additionally, like we said, there's more money than there is, or sorry, there's more fashion than there is money. More is more. And like why pay more? I love spending money. I think a lot of people do. It releases endorphins.
Well, there is a gratification that comes with acquiring something.
So if you can acquire more things for the same amount of funds, to me, that's awesome. You know, you don't want to necessarily sacrifice quality, but do you want to sacrifice quantity also?
Yeah.
So I think it's a great option that people can have.
So do you think that's the only reason why people are starting to buy secondhand versus brand new?
Well, I think across the board, the secondary market is growing due to sustainability. So whether it be furniture, cars, buying things that are reusable and upcyclable, there's that huge aspect. And fashion is an industry that pollutes very heavily, unfortunately. And so there's a big impact by buying on the secondary market. Whether you're buying mass or luxury, there's a huge environmental impact. And I think with luxury, people know that these goods will last a very long time, and therefore they retain equity. So you know that when you're spending money on something, that there's going to be a return there, that there's going to be money in it when you are then done with it and you can pass it on. So even if you weren't the first owner, it still doesn't mean that you're the last owner.
Of course. And do you see attitudes changing towards the secondhand luxury market to what it was 10 years ago?
Oh, 1,000%. 10 years ago, it was like people's dirty little secret. They wouldn't tell their friends about it. They wouldn't, you know, people were like, oh, I love your business, but I'm not telling anyone because it's mine. Because they're like, there wasn't enough inventory to go around, really.
And so finally on this, the market has exploded and this market is huge, but how do you see it growing in the future? Or do you think it's plateaued?
I think it's grown exponentially over the past 10 years and will continue to do so. I believe current estimates are that the luxury resale market's around $24 billion, and I expect that to double in the next 5 years. That's a lot of goods out there and a lot of goods to be traded on, traded up.
And hopefully less going to landfill.
Absolutely. Yeah, keep it in circulation for as long as it can.
So, Graham, how are the luxury brands viewing the whole resale market?
Well, a lot better than they were a decade ago. Let's put it that way. You know, it's interesting. In the jewelry section, brands like Cartier, Harry Winston, they would always kind of showcase some antique or vintage mm-hmm. pieces in their stores, almost as a way to get people there. But with fashion, that was never the case. And now we're seeing a lot more references to the archives, bringing back archival pieces, not necessarily, you know, 30 years even, but like things from just a few seasons ago, a print that was really cool. Mm-hmm. So they're seeing the popularity of the resale market and they're using that to their advantage. Mm-hmm. Are they publicly partnering with the resale market? Not so much. We see a few little partnerships. The Real Real has partnerships with Stella McCartney and Burberry to promote sustainability mm-hmm. and the reconsignment of goods. We saw that Richemont acquired Watchfinder, which is a UK-based resale platform for watches. So that's the first instance of a large conglomerate getting into the resale space.
And what do you think the brands could gain from really embracing this market?
Sure. So what the brands are getting intrinsically is equity in their product. If an item has no value on the secondary market, mm-hmm. why would you buy it in the primary market? The more equity your item has down the road and maintains for its lifespan, the easier a buy it is for the customer. So that's what they're getting. And if they embrace that and partner with these different platforms, they can learn so much about what the consumer wants, who the consumer really is, and what's the next generation of consumer. When you have your aspirational customer looking to make their first foray into luxury goods, maybe it's not going into the boutique and buying a keychain. Maybe it's going to the secondary market and buying a handbag. Maybe it's the same price.
Yeah.
So, but once you acquire that, once the brand acquires that customer, regardless of platform or avenue, they're normally loyal.
So do you think that there is any value, or do you think that any of these brands would look at buying into or owning one of these resale platforms?
Sure. I think we're starting to see that, not just with Watchfinder and Richemont, but with Louis Vuitton announcing that they're working on a blockchain or developing a blockchain for their products. Mm-hmm. There's no point of having a register for provenance if there's no secondary market for it. Recently, Christie's started a blockchain as well for fine art, and we see Louis Vuitton doing the same thing. There's a third-party consortium called Ariane, which is a nonprofit out of France, that's also creating a blockchain for luxury. So that's all part of accepting resale and promoting it.
I think it's very much a fluid area at the moment. It seems to be sort of very much watch this space.
Yes. It's very much watch this space.
Does it then make sense for a company like LVMH to purchase The Real Real?
Well, LVMH is a little preoccupied with Tiffany & Company right now, but I think that data that The Real Real and other luxury platforms have is extremely valuable to these brands. So whether acquiring the whole reseller or just partnering with them for the data access is of huge value to these brands.
I mean, that's what it's all about, the data.
Yeah, info is everything.
Graham, thank you so much. I am Natalie Sady, and this is Sady Says.